two sections. We'll go verse 1 through 4, and then we'll go 5 through 12 later on. One of my favorite chapters of the Bible, Matthew 16, as we get into it. I do have favorites in the Bible. It's probably in my top 10. I'm really excited just over the next couple weeks. We kind of hit the high point, what many people call the high point of Matthew. We're on next week with Peter confessing Jesus as the Messiah. And then into some great stuff after that, too. So do everything you can to make those some very good stuff. So we're just going to go ahead and get into it here today, and then we'll kind of do a summary of where we're at, and then we'll get going. So Matthew 16, verses 1 through 12, and we're going to start with just verses 1 through 4 there. Here we go. And the Pharisees and Sadducees came to test him. They asked him to show them a sign from heaven. He answered them, "When it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be stormy today, for the sky is red and threatening. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of Jonah." So he left them and departed. Father, please speak to us tonight, God. Through your word. God, help us just to see the necessity and just the urgency of your message to us. But we don't know when our last breath is coming. And God, if there's anyone in this place that does not know you, hit them with that sense of urgency tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Basically, chapter 15, got into the last couple of weeks. It started with the Pharisees and scribes coming from Jerusalem to see Jesus. They hadn't seen him yet, okay? And they heard all these things about Jesus, this Jesus guy and the teaching, so they came to see him. And they started just like kind of going after him and his disciples, saying, "Why don't your disciples wash their hands before they eat?" And so Jesus and them had a little spat, and then Jesus called them blind. Blind guides were leading other people in the pit, and then he left, and he went into the areas of Tyre and Sidon, and there he meets this Canaanite woman, who's a Gentile, an ancient enemy of the Israelites, and she has great faith, as Jesus puts it. She falls down at his feet and just begs for her daughter to be healed, and he grants it to her. And so he then leaves there, and he goes into more Gentile territory, and he heals many, and he feeds 4,000 men, Gentiles among them, both Jewish and Gentiles. And so all good things, right, in the last couple of weeks, we see the great faith of this Canaanite woman, and then we go back and we see a bunch of healings and everything, and right here Jesus comes back to Galilee, to his hometown, where it's a mostly all Jewish area, and what do we see right from the get-go? More strife, more opposition. And so, something that's really interesting is, it says it was the Pharisees and the Sadducees that came to seek a sign from Jesus. This is the only time in all the Gospels that we see the Pharisees and the Sadducees together. These are two groups that hated each other. Like, there were two groups that were in the same Sanhedrin, like the major ruling body of the Jewish people at the time, and they had different beliefs. Pharisees were really about the oral law, okay, like this law that had been passed down, the commentary on the Old Testament. And the Sadducees, they just came about the written word, mostly just the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch, or the books Moses wrote, so Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And so they were always too bad alike. Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection after the dead or anything like that. Pharisees did, and so they always had it out. I don't know, like, if you, like, been following, like, our government and everything, Republican, but think of that. It's like that. Like, we're not going to get along, right? We're just in opposition to each other. But here they both come together to oppose Jesus and to test him. So Jesus unites, sometimes in bad ways, too. And what do they want? They're seeking a sign from Jesus. And here's the deal. Jesus has already done many, many signs. Many, many. He had just fed 4,000 men, probably 10,000 to 15,000 people with a couple of fish and some loaves of bread. And they no doubt heard of all those miracles that he'd done, but they haven't seen it with their own eyes. And yet they still want another sign. Jesus says, hey, look, guys, you can tell like it's going to be a stormy day, and all this is going on around you, and you can't see anything. You can't tell anything right now. And the fact is, they'd already made up their mind about Jesus. Like, the jury was out. It was done. He was a false teacher, is what they thought. If he would have done a sign for them, no doubt they probably would have said, this man is a witch, and would have condemned him for witchcraft and tried to stone him to death for that. They were done with him at this point. All they want to do at this point is to discredit him. They are totally unwilling to accept the available evidence that was brought forward to them, like many people are today. And so, first thing about seeking a sign, we're going to be talking about seeking a sign from God. First thing it does is it puts God to the test, right? We're just putting Jesus to the test. This is not the first time that the Pharisees have done this. They did this back in chapter 12, too. They demanded a sign. Now, there was one other person who actually demanded the sign of Jesus prior in the Gospel of Matthew. Do you recall who he is? Satan, in chapter 4. So we have Satan who tests Jesus onto the Pharisees, and now the Pharisees and the Sadducees, following in the Father's footsteps, as Jesus would say in the Gospel of John. Here's the thing, like, when you put God to the test, who's in charge? Who's in charge right here, the Pharisees or Jesus? The Pharisees are. They're the authority. They're acting as the authority. They're saying, do this or else. So they're playing Lord, they're playing Master, they're playing authority, and they're basically making Jesus into the puppet. He does as we ask or else. It's like the bully on the playground. Give me a bunch of money or else, right? And I'm like, I know we generally don't do that today, but in other ways do you do that? Like, so Jesus, I'll follow you, I'll give you my life if. There's that if word in there. If you provide for my family, if you give me a healthy child, if I'm comfortable, if I have this. You make it conditional discipleship. And it was never meant to be conditional, it's unconditional. Jesus, I'll just follow you because you're Jesus. And I remember when I was back in high school, this was, I've told this story before, but this was me, this is what I believe Jesus to be. He was not a king, he was nothing like that. You know who I believe Jesus to be? He's my magic genie. And he was supposed to give me what I wanted. And in turn, for him giving me what I wanted, then I would try to be a pretty good kid. I wouldn't party too much. I would try to use pretty good language in front of my parents and in front of my grandma. The other times it didn't really matter too much. I would just try to be a pretty good kid if he gave me what I wanted. And then, you know, one day, that didn't happen. I didn't get what I wanted, and I totally turned my back on him and said, I'm done with you. I never believed in Jesus. I was my own God. I was my authority. He was not my Lord. I was. And right when he knew what I wanted, I cast him aside. Showed me who I truly was and who he was in my life. He was my magic genie. But he is not a genie. He is the Lord Almighty. He is not a puppet. Next, seeking sign shows us a lack of faith. We see this from the Pharisees and the Sadducees here. It shows their lack of faith. They don't have any faith in Jesus Christ. And when we seek a sign, it shows, or for God to do something in our lives and we demand it of him, it shows the same exact thing. We want our way and we don't really trust his way. And it's okay to plead with God and to ask him for something, but to put him to a test is a totally different thing. When you say that, or else, or if you don't, this is what's going to happen. You do that, we kind of just admit, like, I believe you have all the power. I'll give you that, God. You are sovereign. You are all powerful. But we don't quite trust that he's good. We don't believe Romans 8:28 that says, all things work together for good for those who love God. We kind of just say, well, God, I believe my way is better, so please give me my way here. I don't trust your way. I know best. So it shows a lack of faith in our part, a lack of trust in Him. And lastly, Jesus talked about the sign of Jonah. We got to go back to Matthew 12 to really put some perspective on it. This is when they tested Him before. And says this: "Then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered Him, saying, 'Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you.' But He answered them, 'An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of a great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth.'" So when He says this, no sign will be given except the sign of Jonah to His generation, He's talking about His own resurrection. He's foretelling them that it's going to happen. And this is the greatest sign that God did at the end of Jesus' earthly life, to affirm everything that Jesus said or did. And what a sign it was. If you were there and you saw that and you still didn't believe, you got no excuse. And it's kind of the same thing with us today. It calls for a response. There's a ton of evidence for the resurrection. Is there everything you need to, beyond a doubt, say, "Wow, Jesus rose from the dead"? No. But there's a ton of evidence for it, and a lot of people just push that all away. But it demands a response. You can't just look at the evidence and say, "Who cares?" You must make a choice. And so that is the sign we still have today, the sign of Jonah. Alright, so now let's get into verses 5 through 12. "When the disciples reached the other side, they had forgotten to bring any bread. Jesus said to them, 'Watch and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees.' And they began discussing it among themselves, saying, 'We brought no bread.' But Jesus heard it and said, 'Oh, you of little faith, why are you discussing among yourselves the fact that you have no bread? Do you not yet perceive? Do you not remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and how many baskets you gathered? Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000 and how many baskets you gathered? How is it that you fail to understand that I did not speak about bread? Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees.' Then they understood that He did not tell them to beware of the leaven of bread, but of the teaching of the Pharisees and the Sadducees." So they get to this boat, they're leaving this area, now Jesus is sick of the Pharisees and the Sadducees yet again, and they get in the boat and they leave. And apparently they forgot to bring any bread with them. You see where the disciples' mind is at this point, very physical, worldly things. They're worried about the bread. And they just have no idea what's going on here. They don't get it. And so what I want to talk about now is faith and understanding. Jesus says a couple different things here. First, He says, "Oh, you of little faith." And then He gets into it. He says, "How do you not yet perceive? How is it you fail to understand?" So in this way, Jesus kind of links the disciples' faith and their understanding. And it's something we don't always put together, but I think we do. The two are definitely linked together. You can't separate faith and understanding. They go hand in hand. And they need to go together. So, here's an example. Faith requires some level of understanding. The disciples who lack faith. Why? Because they didn't have understanding. Jesus had just done these two amazing miracles in feeding 5,000 men and 4,000 men. It was meant to convene that He could provide for all of Israel and for all of the world. That's what it means by those baskets that were left over. There was 12 signifying Israel and 7 signifying the rest of the world. And the disciples are worried because they don't have bread. They missed the entire point of the miracles. They didn't have understanding, so they didn't tell me they had any bread, freaking out. And Jesus is like, "How did you get this? Guys, you missed the whole point of the teaching." And here's why these things go together. Like, how are you going to have faith if you don't know what you should put your trust in? How are you going to have faith if you don't know who to believe in? Paul makes this point in Romans 10. He says, "How then will they call on Him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in Him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching?" Shows us the importance of the gospel right there. That's why Jesus commanded us to go out into the world. So people have never heard about Jesus. How can they put their faith in Jesus? How can they believe that He died for their sins on the cross? They never heard about it. And so for us to put our faith in Jesus, we have to have some level of understanding. We have to hear. We have to know about Jesus in some way. You don't have to have a PhD in theology to do it. No. You just need to hear the simple good news that Jesus Christ came down to earth as a man, God, and he died on the cross for you. Repent and put your faith in him. That's it. But you need to hear that. So, with our greater understanding, really, we should have greater faith. And I would say that too. Like, I tell you guys to get to the Word all the time. That's why we have lots of Bible studies around here. We need to get to the Word, because the more you know this, and you know of the promises of God, and you see in this book time and time again that God has fulfilled every single one of his promises, how can your faith not grow? Do you know what I'm saying? How are you going to know all the promises God has if you're not in this book? And he says, don't worry. You don't need to worry anymore. Get in the Word. That's why I say it, guys. It's past and present faithfulness. This tells us all about it. But with that being said, on the flip side of it, knowledge without faith is absolutely worthless. Pharisees had all the knowledge in the world, but they didn't have faith. And if anything, they probably sentenced them more than anything in the world. They had all the Old Testament prophets that pointed straight to Jesus, and yet they didn't put their faith in him. Probably we're saying the same as believing these days, and I think that's complete kind of BS. Seeing as not believing, because the Pharisees here, they had seen, and yet they did not believe. And there's a lot of people who say, well, I want to see today, have Jesus show me a miracle, or like kind of, they want to see a sign from them to believe. And what else do you need? This whole thing that we call the church today started with 12 nobodies, a couple of fishermen, a zealot, and look at what it is today. In this room, I could just start pulling people up here and asking them about their stories, and as Don talked about last week, we would just see lives transformed by hearing a simple message and putting our faith in Jesus. And we could see it time and time again. I could pull many people up here right now, and they would all say the same thing. I gave my life to Jesus, and everything changed. Talk about heroin addicts that just stop because they give their life to the Lord and they're a new person. They were once dead and now they're alive. The things they used to love, they now hate. And the thing they used to hate, they now love. The truth of the matter is, we must believe to see. Seeing is not living, we must believe to truly see. And I've told you many times about in Ashland when I picked up a Bible, and it made sense for once in my life. And I read it before, and I opened it up, and I started reading Matthew, and I just started crying because it all made sense for the first time in my life. Because I believed. The Holy Spirit came to me and showed me the truth that was right there that I had passed over every single time. It's my favorite thing to see as being a pastor. There's things that stink as being a pastor, but the best thing is when somebody comes to know the Lord and you see their life just change. You say, there is a new creation. Michael Wilson, there is a new creation. Gary Meisenheimer, there is a new creation. That is a different person. That is a new man. That is not the same person anymore. And you ask them, like, when they start getting into this world, they're just like on fire, and they don't want to put it down, and they just, they couldn't stand it before. It was the most violent thing in the world, and now they can't put it down. How much proof do people need? It's a supernatural thing. To that point, I want to say this. You can memorize this entire Bible. The Bible is an amazing thing. It is God's gift to us. You can have the whole thing memorized and it can still be worthless unless you put it into practice in your life. The Bible calls us to live lives of faith. It's like if you read all about the paleo diet, right? You guys know what the paleo diet is. And you just researched it and you read all this stuff. You're like, this has got to be the greatest diet ever. And then you just want to make pizza every day. What good is all that knowledge to you? It doesn't do you any good. Same thing, you know this whole book. it's our word, and yet we don't live by faith, because that's exactly what this calls us to do. It tells us the story of God, who he is, and he says, put your trust in him alone. Jesus said at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, he had this great teaching, and it's still one of my favorite passages, where he says, whoever hears these words of mine and acts on them is like a sensible man who built his house on a rock. The winds came, the storms came, and yet it stood because it was built on the rock. But whoever hears these words of mine and does not act on them is like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the winds came, the storms came, and it was totally destroyed. You can have this book memorized, but if you don't put it into practice, it does us no good. Our next point, it's our last point, is beware. Jesus says, beware the teachings of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And throughout the Bible, there is no tolerance for false teaching. There is not one place in the entirety of Scripture where you will see any kind of tolerance to false teaching. I won't say mercy, because mercy would be that God didn't strike you, but God just doesn't like false teaching at all. Let's just say that. From the Israelites to the prophets, to Jesus, to Paul, to Peter, to John, to every single one of the writings, look at it, and you'll see that there's time and time again, they don't say, hey, beware of atheists, beware of pagans, beware of this or that. They don't. They say, beware of the teaching that's going to come in the midst of you. Every single time. And that's kind of weird for us today, because today's chief sin, the biggest sin I think you can make in this culture, is to not accept someone else's beliefs, or to criticize someone else's beliefs. But what is the saying? To each his own. We all heard that, to each his own. And that's fine, like if you're talking about a grilled cheese sandwich or your musical preference, but if you're talking about God and morality, not so cool. If you're talking about absolute truths. So, she texted today, we were talking about into where to possibly gather for Easter, but I don't think they have enough, but anyway, so she said she's in Laodicea today. She sent me some pictures of Laodicea, and of course, if you know the Bible, that's in Turkey, and it's famous for Jesus' letter to the church in Laodicea, right? It's a pretty famous letter. It's in Revelation 3. And I just get some stupid ideas sometimes, and I don't know if they're from the Lord or not, but just like, maybe we should just read this letter to the church of Laodicea, but let's do it in today's mindset, our cultural mindset of today, to each his own. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea, write the words of the Amen, the faith and the true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works, you are neither cold nor hot. You are either cold or hot, but you are lukewarm. And that's okay, because I really like the fact that you're trying out both the cold and the hot. It gives you a lot of diversity and experience. Nice job. For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing. Not really, for you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing. It's good self-confidence. Good for them. Not realizing that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. And that's okay, too. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich in white garments, or blue, or black, or red, or orange, whatever your preference is, so that you may clothe yourself, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen. But if you are naked, that's okay too. No need to feel any shame about that. It's all good. Teach them all. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent, if you want to. Like, it's totally up to you. It's totally cool. Either way, no worries. If you're not ready, you're not ready. It's okay. Just take your time. It's all good. You don't even really need to repent. You don't say that word. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him, and he with me. But if you're busy right now, it's cool. I'll wait. It's all good. If you've got company, if the place is a mess, just wait. It's all good. The one who conquers, I will bring him to sat with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches, or not. It doesn't really matter. Teach his own. So, I don't know if I made an actual point there. I hope I did. You can't read the Bible with that mindset. You can't. It flies in the face of all scripture. That do whatever you want, to each his own. Throughout the Bible, God says there is a truth, and this is it. And maybe we're varying little rules on what that is from denomination to denomination, and that's fine. But not in the primary things, it's quite clear in here. The church is called to be vigilant. We are all called to be vigilant and discerning in these matters, not hyper-vigilant, but on alert for false teaching. I wanted to share this from 1 Corinthians 5. I forgot about this passage just talking about. It's kind of weird to look at ourselves as the church, first and foremost, before we look at anybody else on the outside. And this is Paul writing to the church at Corinth, who had all sorts of issues. I write to you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people, not at all meaning the sexually immoral of this world, or the greedy and swingers, or idolaters, since then you need to go out of the world. But now I am writing to you not to associate with anyone who bears the name of a brother if he is guilty of sexual immorality, or greed, or is an idolater, or a reviler, a drunkard, a swindler, not even to eat with such a one. For what have I to do with judging outsiders? Is it not those inside the church whom you are to judge? God judges those outside. Curse the evil person from among you. It's a pretty shocking statement. You might blush a little bit when I say that. But it shows you how much God cares about the purity of his church. What we are to be. And it's my job as pastors to be a shepherd first and foremost. To teach you the word, to feed you, but also to be on the lookout for wolves. And so, if there's a false teaching, I'll tell you about it. I'm not saying I know better, I just judge it by this. And if it flies contrary to this, then it's false, in my opinion. I was going through, after I wrote this, and I went through once, and I'm like, wow, I actually have to say that? Jesus had this part, it just made sense to me. Wrote to you, who are liked by all men. For some of these false prophets who were before you. And it just actually made sense to me today. Because a lot of the things we have to say up here, out of love for all of you, and to keep you away from that, hurt. And they're not popular at all. So, what do we need to do? We need to be discerning. You guys see false teaching every single day of your lives. Every single day, whether it's in podcasts or social media or TV or advertising or your friends or your coworkers, there will be a different worldview from that of the Bible, a biblical worldview. And we're called just to be on alert of those things. And Jesus tells us to look at the fruit. Look at the fruit of who is saying these things. Look at the teaching. Does it coincide with this? It's your best measure right here. The Word of God. And your lives. It's not like everyone's going to be perfect. There's a teacher, but do the lives match this to some regard? And what I wanted to do right now is look at... Because, the New Testament, most of those letters, they all combat false teaching. So I want to look at some of the false teaching that was happening back in Jesus' day and in the first century. And really, once I looked into it, I think we can narrow every false teaching that happens today into those three things. And the first is this, it's legalism. And that's exactly what the Pharisees were. Later on, after Jesus was really resurrected from the dead, they were called Judaizers because they would come and they'd say, well, you're saved by faith, and you need to get circumcised, and you need to do this, and you need to keep this law, and you need to keep this festival. And it's basically just saying it's salvation by works and not just faith alone. So Galatians 1, Paul writes about the Judaizers right here, this legalism, and this is what he says. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you seek, let him be accursed. That Greek word is anathema, and it means that he'll be cursed for all eternity. And so I don't think Paul is saying that to each his own. Far from it. So legalism is basically what a lot of the world is. Every time you ask somebody, do you need to go to hell? And they say, yes, why? Because I'm a good person. That's works by salvation. It's worth salvation. And that's kind of what legalism is. Next is the exact opposite of that, and it's called antinomianism. That's a great word. And it's the exact opposite because it just means no law. It's people who say, I've said a prayer or I've done something, so now I can do whatever I want. I've been baptized as an infant, now I can just go and live my life however I want because I'm saved. Paul is actually accused of that by the church at Rome, and so in Romans 6, he wrote back to him and says, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Grace is an amazing, awesome thing. The last song we're going to sing tonight is my favorite song probably in the world, Amazing Grace. And it is an amazing thing, but if you think that grace gives you the right to sin, you don't understand grace at all. You have no clue what grace is. Randy Alcorn puts it like this. Any concept of grace that makes us feel more comfortable sinning is not biblical grace. God's grace never encourages us to live in sin. On the contrary, it empowers us to say no to sin and yes to truth. Grace is the most amazing thing in the entire world. To know that Jesus Christ came down and died in my place for no reason other than his love for me. And he did that for me. And I don't deserve it in any way. There's nothing I could do to deserve it. And he just caused me to trust in that. Believe that and then say, oh, I'm just going to go and live my life rebelling against him for what he's done. You see how those two things don't match? When we truly understand God's grace and what he has done, people don't actually teach real grace because you know what it means? It means your life is not your own and God can ask whatever he wants of you and you have to give it to him because he has done everything for you. Everything. We truly see what grace is. He doesn't even say it like that, but he just said, when you see it for what it is, you see that the only reasonable thing that we can do with our lives is to give our lives 100% to Jesus Christ, holding nothing back whatsoever. And with antinomianism gets this idea of cheap grace that came about by Dietrich Bonhoeffer in his book, The Cost of Discipleship. And it's kind of like a get-out-of-jail-free card, right? It's like you don't get it from the community, you get it from the grace chest, and it's your get-out-of-hell-free card, right? You can live your life however you want, but you just pull the grace card. Somebody, loving brother or sister comes to you and says, hey, I'm really concerned about this in your life, out of love, and you say, huh, no, God's grace. Guys, if that's your fallback, that's not biblical grace in any way. Can you imagine what that'd be like? You live your whole life in rebellion to God, and you go up there, and he's like, okay, what do you have to say? And he's will allow us to get out of the jail free card and say, hey, grace. You didn't play God like that? You think that's going to work out? Maybe. I don't see it in the Bible anymore, though. Antinomianism. Guys, this is why we must all be born again. I'm sorry, I get pretty fired up about that one, because I'm not even Matthew 7, there's that part in there, like, I never knew you depart from me, workers of lawlessness. That's exactly what he's talking about. There's going to be a lot of people on that last day who go right there and say, what? Sure, there's a church here and there. Depart from me, I never knew you, you workers of lawlessness. So that's antinomianism. Last is Gnosticism. So Gnosticism was like a secret knowledge. It was very anti-flesh. It was all about the spiritual. Anything that was fleshly was bad. It was about unlimited human freedom, right? And we see this mostly at the end of the first century, into the second century. We see John's letters have to do with it. But this is alive and well in this new spirituality that is very much up and coming today. But the really important thing about Gnosticism is this, that secret knowledge, the anti-flesh, the unlimited human freedom, those are all huge Greek concepts of the day. They were very much alive in the Greek culture of the time. So really what's at the heart of Gnosticism is this, it was to make Christianity appeal to the culture by becoming like it. So what they did is they just took these things that were very popular in Greek culture at the time, they put them in Christianity, and they blended the two together. And that was Gnosticism in a nutshell. And I think this is probably the greatest threat today. Think of it this way, what do you get when you take the American dream and you blend it with the gospel? You get the prosperity gospel. God wants you to be rich, be healthy, and all those things. And you blend that with the gospel, you get the prosperity gospel. And it happens when you take our self-centered, self-absorbing culture and you blend it with the gospel, you get the self-help gospel. It's all about all of you in the end. And Jesus actually says, no, it's actually about denying yourself and taking up your cross and following me. This happens when you take postmodernism and all these things that come about from there. There is no absolute truth, right? Even our church is just, it's all about feelings and experiences now. And what happens when you take the religious pluralism, that there's only subjective truth that's so popular today, and then you put that into the church where you get universalism and all passive to God. Each thing. So what we must ask ourselves as a church is, who do we seek to please? Do we seek to please God or the culture? And who are we being faithful to in the end? Actually, it's on my phone. I saw this in an article today, or not this week, and I had to take a picture of it. The article in the Gospel Coalition says, writing about St. Francis of Assisi, G.K. Chesterton said, it is the great paradox of history that each generation is converted by the saint who contradicts it the most. Chesterton believed, when a generation gets too worldly, it is up to the saint or the church to rebuke it. St. Francis embodied this cultural rebuke by the life he lived. The saint is not what the people want, but rather what the people need. Chesterton says that the saint is someone who runs incongruous with the modern world. Next thing, guys, don't be surprised by all this false teaching. Jesus said it was going to happen, especially at the end. He said, for false Christ and false prophets will arise and perform signs and wonders to lead astray, if possible, the elect. But be on guard, I have told you all things beforehand. He told us it's all going to happen. Don't be discouraged either. Like, a lot of people get really discouraged by it. So why does God allow false teachers? Why would he allow this? Not an easy answer, but I thought of it like this, like, what is the church called in Revelation? We're called the Bride of Christ, right? He is our groom. Marriages are pretty awesome and weddings are pretty awesome because it's two people who have made the decision to spend the rest of their life together, through thick and thin and through everything else. And the thing that makes it really awesome is that they chose that person. Marriage wouldn't be as cool if there was no other choices but one person, right? But I chose you, and you chose me to spend the rest of our lives together out of all those other options. So why does God allow it? Maybe for that reason. That we freely choose Him above all the other temptations and all the other things of this world, that we want Him and Him alone, and then He gets the glory. Coming back, God's not going to force our hand in anything we do. Keep imagining this, just seeing at the end of the judgment where the bride, New Jerusalem comes down, and the church, His bride, is made splendid for Him, shining like the sun, right? And the tears spread out, they're dissected, got the guy who's going down into an eternal pit of torment, and he's saying, why them, why not me, why not me? And I just picture God saying to each his own. You get that choice right here, right now, of who you belong to. Do you belong to Jesus Christ? Do you belong to this world? Who do you belong to? Don't kid yourself. Don't say, oh, Lord, do you? Do you belong to Him? Because we don't know what the future holds, guys. A lot of crazy stuff happening in this time.